your attention to just a few announcements today. One of them, it's not even up here. Somebody told me about this last week, and then another pastor contacted me, and then I saw it on one of the, I think, crosswalk.com, and then Caleb had it on. Does anybody know what today is? Captain Obvious strikes again. It's Welcome Back to Church Sunday. So, welcome back. Glad to see all of you here today. So we have just a couple of things I'd like to draw to your attention. First of all, the computer is not cooperating with me. So, yes, there we go. Thank you for the help upstairs. Tonight at 6 p.m., those of you who have expressed an interest in going to Alaska this next August, I'd like for you to be here. We're going to be talking about kind of a timeline, some of the things we're looking at for different fundraisers, the different costs that are involved with it, different activities that we'll be involved with when we are up in Alaska, when you are up in Alaska. So be sure to be here at that this evening. Right now we've got 21 people that have expressed an interest, which is quite amazing. Bob Slocum was saying if we have 15, that will just be incredible. That will be beyond incredible. So be sure to be at that this evening at 6 o'clock. Now, thank you, Slide Air Change. Thank you. This is the next thing. Friday, Janita, can you just stand up and give instructions to the ladies that are going to the Camp Maria?
Oh, okay. Well, I think we've all met and decided that we're meeting here at the church at 10:15, leaving at 10:30. And we're meeting in Portland at the
Panera
Bread for lunch.
Augusta.
Augusta. Thank you. Meeting at Augusta. So if you're not able to leave right at that time, which is three vehicles going. So anyway, there will be 12 of us that will be missing next Sunday, but we'll definitely be back.
All right, wonderful. And please keep an eye on my wife. It's Augusta. That's good. Okay, after the worship service this morning, we want to just hang around for about 10 to 15 minutes just to talk about, to talk about some of the things that we're doing with safety and working with the ushers and things like that. It's just information, nothing earth-shattering, but we live in a different world today. And as elders and trustees and ushers, we felt the need to just keep you informed, because if you start looking around saying, what's going on, or why is this door locked, or whatever, we'll explain to you later on why that is, okay? So, enough family meeting business. It's time to worship the Lord.
Thank you for joining us here today. Really appreciate it. I can say this as we have this coming on this week. Happy almost fall. Yeah? Does that sound better than happy end of summer? Yeah, happy almost fall. I like that a lot better than happy end of summer. So, what a wonderful summer we've had. No sunshine, bright sunshine shining out here today. Let's stand as we worship together here this morning. Come, now is the time to worship.
Oh,
pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you and give you praise that just as we are, we can come before you in worship. That just as we are, we can come and bow down and we can humble ourselves and say, thank you, Lord, our God, for loving us, for saving us. We give you our thanks and our praise today. In Jesus' name, amen. Forever we give him thanks. Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. With a mighty hand and outstretched arm, his love endures forever. good times and bad, you are in control. You are on your throne. Help us, Lord, to see that. Help us to see your goodness. Help us to see your grace and your mercy at work in our lives, Lord. I thank you that we have a God who loves us, who is there for us, who is faithful to us. Lord, help us to not... It's easy to get down when things are not going seemingly well. Help us to recognize that you're on our side, that you are for us. You are not against us. And help us to turn to you, Lord, humble ourselves, to cry out to you when we have that need, that you will hear us. And Lord, when seemingly everything is wonderful and great, to cry out to you and say, thank you, Lord, for your blessings. And even in that midst of that valley, still have the presence and the faith, the capacity to cry out to you and say, thank you, Lord, that you are with us. I thank you for your blessings. I thank you even as we take the tithe and the offering, Lord, that we can say, you are God, Lord. Do you provide for us in ways that we don't even realize much of the time? Lord, open our eyes that we might see you clearly in your Son, Jesus Christ. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Amen.
It's so easy to get distracted and to focus upon the things all around us. Help us to fix our eyes upon Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. Help us to look to Him who is our refuge, our strength. Help us to rely completely upon the Holy Spirit to guide us, to direct us, to help us to say no to ungodliness and yes to godliness. Father, we would ask that even now, you know exactly what's going on in each of our lives. Those things right now that would distract us, that would keep us from worshiping Jesus, we would ask that you would take them away from our minds as only you can. Help us to listen to your Holy Spirit. And Father, help me to speak the words that you once said. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated.
Children, come up for children's church.
Feed on each other. If you want to understand Revelation, you need to understand Daniel. And they help complement each other. Some of you will recall that when we first came here, within the first few years, I actually preached a series in Revelation. This is the first time I'm preaching through the book of Daniel. So, please pray for me. It's going to be a fun time. It's going to be a challenging time. And I hope, Lord willing, that we will all benefit from this study. And some of you are saying, why are we preaching through Daniel? Well, this time around, I knew I was going to be finishing up the Gospel of John, so I asked the elders, gentlemen, what do you sense God wants to be speaking to our congregation about? And interestingly, we all came to the conclusion, Daniel. Especially in view of the world in which we are living today, how are we supposed to respond with situations and incidents very much like what was happening here with the Babylonians? After all, how do we live Christian lives in a culture which is not only unfriendly towards the things of Christ, but downright hateful to the things of Christ? Well, obviously, we cannot respond in a way where you go back to the old AT&T commercial and reach out and touch someone. That's not how to witness the love of Christ, is it? It's not how to show them if you really believe when Jesus said, love your enemies. Because it doesn't show up when you want to hurt somebody. You cannot be seen as loving, you cannot be seen as light, if you and I as Christians are firing missiles and throwing hand grenades at those who oppose the things of Christ. Today we're going to start to lay a bit of a foundation. We're going to be looking at some young men who were really out of their element. They were in a foreign land that did not look at God the way that they looked at God. In fact, these four individuals, without any guilt of their own, were sent into exile and away from their homeland. If anybody could say, this isn't fair, these four guys could have said that. So how did they respond? Well, we as God's people, we're placed in a world that is opposed to God. We sometimes get to experience things that are hurtful, even though we're not at fault. How should we respond? Francis Schaeffer wrote a book several decades ago entitled, How Should We Then Live? Some of you may know a follow-up on that written by Colson, How Then Should We Live? And in view of the world in which we find ourselves, this is a very real question for those of us who are Christians, who are followers of Jesus Christ. This next slide is where we want to focus on. There's no rocket science in this, okay? God is faithful. Do we agree on that?
Amen.
God is faithful, and we need to be faithful. God is faithful. That's a given, right? But are we always faithful? We need to be. Now, before we get into the text for today, let's imagine a little bit more about the scenario and maybe hopefully understand it a bit more. These four young men that we're going to be looking at, we're going to actually see their names today and talk a little bit about them. They came from royal lineage. They were actually considered princes. Not princesses. Princes. They were guys. Okay? But because of the sins of the nation, they, along with many other innocent individuals, were going to suffer along with the rest of the people. How many of you, my age and a few years younger, remember physical education classes? Okay? Remember when somebody was horsing around and did something that was totally inappropriate? Who got punished?
The whole class.
Now, I love running, but there's a point. It just got crazy. Well, you know something? That's kind of a walk in the park compared to what these guys had to go through. They may have been innocent, but because the rest of the nation, the majority of the people, were rebellious against God, they get to suffer right along with the rest of the class. Because of the fact that the people did not repent and obey, all the prophecies that Jeremiah and many other prophets gave were coming true. And that is that the Babylonians would come, take over, and capture the people. Now, the Babylonian means of conquering a people were very similar to what happens today. They would take away the best and the brightest of that nation they were conquering, specifically of the youth. And they would bring them to their nation, to Babylon. And there they would train them, they would instruct them, and they would attempt to make these best and the brightest of the young people leaders in their own nation. That way, you remove them from ever going back helping out their own nation. You have them. As we'll read in verse 4, these young men were well-rounded. They were the cream of the crop. The whole purpose of the Babylonian leadership was to take these four young men, along with several others, and to turn them from Jews to Babylonians, to make them think, dream, and behave as Babylonians. Does that sound familiar to anybody as to how Satan wants to work in our lives? See, Satan doesn't want us to be Christians in the world. He wants the world in the Christian. He doesn't want us to be transforming and impacting the world. He wants the world to impact the Christian and conform us to be like the world. So we're going to take some time and see if we can glean some lessons from the book of Daniel. We're going to be reading Daniel chapter 1 through 7, and you're going to need to just kind of follow along here as I get through each verse. And this is from the New American Standard. Whatever translation you have, feel free to follow along in. That's going to say the same thing, just use different words. But this will be the New American Standard. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. The Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, along with some of the vessels of the house of God. And he brought them to the land of Shinar, to the house of his God, and he brought the vessels into the treasury of his God. Then the king ordered Ashpenaz, the chief of his officials, to bring in some of the sons of Israel, including some of the royal family and of the nobles, youths in whom was no defect, who were good-looking, showing intelligence in every branch of wisdom, endowed with understanding and discerning knowledge, and who had ability for serving in the king's court. And he ordered him to teach them the literature and the language of the Chaldeans. The king appointed for them a daily ration from the king's choice food and from the wine which he drank, and appointed that they should be educated 3 years, at the end of which they were to enter into the king's personal service. Now, among them, from the sons of Judah, were Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Then the commander of the officials assigned new names to them. To Daniel he assigned the name Belteshazzar, to Hananiah Shadrach, to Mishael Meshach, and to Azariah Abednego. That is the passage we're going to be looking at today. Now we're going to start off in verses 1 and 2. And we're going to see that we and they were encouraged to be faithful even in a foreign culture. Okay? Our family were all U.S. citizens. James is a dual citizen. He's a citizen of Canada and the U.S. Okay? But you know something? That's not really my citizenship. Because of Jesus Christ, my citizenship is in heaven. Okay, this is just an earthly, planetary thing. So as we start this series, we begin with a brief description giving a little information about the history and events and people involved. Now even though this is a book of prophecy, it's found in the section of the major prophets, the style is completely different from all the other prophetic books. In fact, the style is almost like a biographical, historical style of reading. It covers Daniel and what happened to Daniel, how God spoke to Daniel, and his three friends. The other prophets were very specific in their ministry, focusing on relaying information from God to specific nations or to specific peoples. Now Daniel, his role was really not that of a prophet, right? His role was that of a historian and a government official. Fascinating. The time frame with Daniel is actually dealing with the shortest time frame of the major prophets, but it covers the most time and territory of any of the other prophets. So you see, you've got a few short chapters, covers a very small period of time per se, but the information is about the largest span of time of any. Most scholars have rated Daniel as among the wisest and learned men. The Jewish rabbis would rank him right up with Moses and Solomon. So we've got a little background information. Next slide, please. Here in the first two verses, we're given a synopsis of the historical setting. Now, please divert your eyes away from everything that way. You're just looking right there, okay? I know it's real hard. I told you not to look. What are you doing? Yeah, I know. So we're at 605 BC here. And this is the first of what we know to be three sieges against Jerusalem by the Babylonians. So based upon the time frame, you cross-reference 2 Kings 24, 2 Chronicles 36, this would have taken place around 605 BC. Okay? So you'll remember the other kingdom, the northern kingdom, was captured in 721 BC. So we've gone all the way down to 605 BC before we have any major events carried out against the southern kingdom. This capture had been forewarned by several of the prophets. This was not new news. They've been warned about this many times. Now you and I need to know that the captivity took about 70 years. Okay? They were in exile 70 years. You might think, why 70 years? Well, God has an interesting means of natural consequences, don't you know? They had neglected to observe the Sabbath. They had refused to give the land a sabbatical rest. So, if you're not going to obey those things, we're going to make sure the land gets a major sabbatical rest. 70 years you are going to be in exile or in captivity. It's a natural punishment. Another interesting twist is that Babylon was known as the center of idolatry. And it was actually considered one of the most wicked places in the world. We had some friends from Ontario that called us up one time and asked how we were doing this. And we just got back from Sin City. And I very ignorantly said, George, Sin City? What are you talking about? Las Vegas. Everybody knows that's Sin City. Okay, now I know that. But you know, there's certain areas that hit certain titles, and everybody knows what it is. Babylon. You want to go to the wickedest, most evil city in the world? Babylon. That's where you go. Well, you know what? How ironic that the Jews had practiced some of the most vile, wicked idolatry, even sacrificing and eating their own children. You're going, ew? Good. Ew is what it means. They were so turning against God. And so, again, natural consequences. You want to practice idolatry? You want to be as evil as they come? You're going to go where they invented evil. Not literally, but that's kind of the idea. Next slide, please. They're taken away to a land with the people who speak an unknown language. Do you see how far away Judah and Babylon are? It makes it very, very difficult to just walk home at night and feed the livestock. Can't do it. Far, far removed. By the way, that land is what God had promised them would be their land forever. Now, if that doesn't raise some question marks in your mind as a Jew that's just been captured, very much like you and I, we're promised Christ's presence with us at all times, right? But there are times you and I are saying, I don't feel it. Where is it? Already, just from history, we're reminded that when a people choose to ignore God's word, when a people chooses to do whatever they want to do, there will come a day of judgment. Theologian John Walford comments, he said, worldly saints do not capture the world, but instead they become the world's captives. Church, we need to be the church. not Christians who look like the world, not Christians who are worldly minded, because we won't have an impact on the world if we are. Now, some of you are very detail oriented, and I'm glad for that. And as you go home and study this again, as I know you will, you'll notice that the time frame appears to be different in Daniel chapter 1:1 than it was in Jeremiah 25. Because if you're using your cross-reference, you'll see that there's a cross-reference to Jeremiah 25. But let me encourage you with something. It's simply a difference of perspective. Because Daniel, when he wrote this book, had already been trained and schooled in Babylonian ways, their culture, their calendar. So Daniel's going to be writing from the perspective of the Babylonian calendar as opposed to the Jewish calendar. So it works out perfectly, legitimately. There's also some very intentional describing of what was done with some of the vessels of the house of God. Did you catch that? Daniel states that Nebuchadnezzar brought them, this is vessels from the house of God, the temple, brought them to the land of Shinar, to the house of his God, and he brought the vessels into the treasury of his God. All that the Jewish people considered sacred, untouchable, were now in the presence of a false god. King Nebuchadnezzar did that intentionally. He lets everybody know, you may think your God is something else. My God is better. My God captured your God. Very intentional. The next slide shows what we'll be looking at verses 3 and 7. And we need to be encouraged to be faithful even among false teaching. Be faithful even among false teachings. In verses 3 through 7, we see here the king has ordered the best and most elite of the royal young people to be taught the ways of Babylon. He was, in essence, ordering them to be brainwashed and taught how to think like a Babylonian, how to act like a Babylonian, how to promote Babylon. And interestingly, he chose to use the best and the brightest. Because if they could be coerced, if they could be brainwashed the way he wants them to be, others will follow in their steps. They're to be a royal lineage showing their mind. They're to be without any defects showing my stuff is perfect. Their training would be used for several purposes. For one thing, you've got the best and the brightest of the Jewish people. If the people in Jerusalem want to cause problem, they're hostages. They use them for leverage. These students would also be a constant reminder to the people that Nebuchadnezzar could get whatever he wanted, and no one could stop him. Plus, later on down the road, if in fact there has to be any dealings with the people of Israel, these guys know all about it. They know how to deal with them. Next slide, please. Verse 4, it almost sounds like a young lady's description for her ideal man. You know, our girls, a couple of them, have written a list of what their ideal man should be. That's my fault. I wrote a list of what the ideal wife should be years ago. I showed it to my mother. My mother said, son, you're going to be a bachelor. She was wrong. But look at that list. I mean, isn't this list incredible? Good looking, smart, can figure anything out, are able to stand next to the elite and the upper crust in the royal palace. But that's what Nebuchadnezzar wanted. The process after they're approved and meet all these qualifications, then they're to be taught the literature and the language of the Chaldeans. Now you're saying Chaldeans, who are they? Another word for Babylonian. Okay? Chaldean, Babylonian, same thing. This process, if you think about it, if you're taught the literature and language of a people group, and you're forbidden to have any contact with any of your own literature, and you're punished if you speak your own language. You have to speak the language of the Babylonians. You stop thinking like a Jew, a child of God, chosen by God. You begin to think like a Babylonian. This method of absorbing other cultures and reshaping them to serve the desires of their captors is really nothing new. It's gone on throughout history. It still is going on. It can even go on in what used to be considered a free nation. We have the same thing going on today called re-education. People are being forced to take specialized training if they don't agree with sinful behavior and sinful thinking in the marketplace. Now, folks, even today, sometimes we're required to study things that contradict God's Word, the Bible, right? I know one person one time came to me and says, I can't study in my science class because all the teachers evolution. I said, you need to know it. Study it. You don't have to agree with it, but study it. Understand it. I had a music appreciation class in college I had to study. I hated it. It was boring to me. And I didn't agree with the professor at all because he thought that one style of music was the cat's meow, and I thought, ugh. Didn't have to agree, but he didn't study it. Okay? As long as it doesn't take you from God, study it. We're going to see that with these young men. They will study the culture. They will become some of the best. In fact, Daniel will eventually be number two in the whole people. Again, we see the attempt to indoctrinate even more powerfully as the king attempts to influence them to do that which would go against their religious training and beliefs. He offers them the best of that culture with their hospitality and dining. The food was such that Daniel and his friends would evidently feel that later on we'll see that they shouldn't participate or partake of it. One translation describes it as rich food. It doesn't sound too bad to me. But they knew it went against what they were taught they could have. This was a provision from the Babylonians that was designed to enable these young men to have the best of the king's personal provisions so that at the end of the 3-year period of indoctrination and training, they would be able to stand alongside with any of the other Babylonians in the king's personal service. Now, I keep talking about these four young men, and verse 6 lists only four of the many young people conscripted. Well, all I can suggest to you is that these four men probably were the ones who did it right. Because there were a lot of other young men that were conscripted and brought in, but we don't hear anything about them. In fact, later on we're going to hear that it's basically these four that don't bow the knee. So you get the impression that the others, the remainder of the group, maybe they weren't committed to God previously, or maybe they succumbed to the pleasures of this world. You and I know people like that, don't we? People that would say, man, there's great potential there, and yet something grabs a hold of them, and they're no longer living for Christ. And maybe, I don't know. That's a possibility. That may be what happened to the others. Now, Daniel's name, interestingly, is also found in Ezekiel. Why is that? Because Ezekiel was a captive prophet during the same time period. And Ezekiel probably was able to relate back and forth to Daniel, who was in the king's service. So let's take a little time, next slide please, to look at the significance of the names of these four individuals. Names mean a lot, don't they? Names mean a lot. In our family, we've tried to make sure that we pray and God reveals to us names that we believe this next child will be. For all of them, we had a boy's name and a girl's name, because we didn't know until Mindy and Margo came along if it was a boy or a girl. And so, interestingly, they fit their name perfectly. Not because my wife and I are so brilliant, but because we believe God gave us insight. Daniel's name commonly means God is judge. God is judge. Hananiah means Jehovah is gracious. Mishael means who Belshazzar, but God. And finally, Azariah means the Lord helps. Now you might say, well, the writer here must have been told by the teacher you have to have 200 words to hand in tomorrow and you just fill the space up with words. No, there was significance here. I believe there's great significance in stuff like this. It shows me a couple things. One, I believe these four men had godly parents. Their focus was on the Lord. We also get the impression that these four men themselves were followers of God, don't we? If not just here from the names later on, because names could change based upon a child's personality. However, as part of the brainwashing, they're going to be given new names, new identities. You see, if the Babylonians could remove as many traces of their previous heritage, they would be more loyal to the cause of Babylon. Sadly, historians trace the names back as showing that they were giving credit to false gods of the Babylonians. Let me just give you some current day examples. Not current day, but how many of you remember Cassius Clay? How many of you know Muhammad Ali? Same person. Cassius Clay accepted the Muslim faith, changed his name. How many of you remember basketball now, okay? Lew Alcindor. How many of you have heard of Kareem Abdul-Jabbar? Interesting. Lew Alcindor played for the Milwaukee Bucks. One of the first guys that could stuff Will Chamberlain. But he became a Muslim and changed his name. The whole purpose of the name change within the Muslim context, and I'm not saying this to attack, please understand that. I share this from a missionary friend who has worked for 55 years with Islamic people. Part of the reason for the name change is to erase all vestiges of the past and show complete identification and affiliation with the Muslim religion today. Okay? That's just the way it is. So here we have Daniel. His name was changed to Belshazzar. It means may Bel protect his life. Now Bel was one of the chief gods of the Babylonians, B-E-L. Does this sound like some other god from the Canaanites? Baal? There was a direct connection to the Canaanite god Baal. Hananiah was given the name of Shadrach. Scholars suggest that when you break it down, it might mean command of Aku. It seems to be in reference to the god Marduk, who was another Babylonian god. Mishael is given the name of Meshach. And again, the Babylonian language with all their false gods and all that stuff, almost all scholars agree that the Babylonian language was a tough language to break down. Here it says, who is what the moon god is? So now we're giving vocal. Azariah is given the name of Abednego, which probably means servant of Nebo. Nebo was supposed to be the son of Bel. So it's all connected to false gods, right? You see that connection. So there was a very strong intentionality that you're no longer going to hold on to your Jewish name because that had too much connection with Jehovah. You're going to have a Babylonian name and recognize these Babylonian gods. Now, one observation that I want to make from that specifically, even though these four young men, by the way, these young men were probably teenagers when they were first captured. So, teens, you're not off the hook. These aren't wise and old men. These are young men who did it right. Even though they were given names that referenced false gods, they did not follow after those false gods, but continued to serve the one, the living, the true God. Doesn't matter what people will say, what the world may try to do to us, or how they label us, we don't have to serve the God of this world because we continue to serve the light of the world, Jesus Christ. Next slide, please. We're not of this world, but we find ourselves in it, don't we? There used to be a bumper sticker out, "Stop the world, I want to get off." I think God put us here for a reason. We're in the world, but we're not of it. Daniel and his three friends were not of the pagan Babylonian world, but they found themselves in it, didn't they? They didn't have a choice. The question facing all of us is, how will we live out our Christian faith? Because even though we experience life here on this earth as foreigners, we are still to be faithful to God's commands and His expectations, because we know He is faithful. In this, we're also reminded that just because people claim to be following God does not make it so. There will come a day of judgment and punishment. And of course, there's that ultimate judgment of condemnation to hell. But there may very well be, as we've seen multiple times, and seems to continue to happen even today, the punishment comes on this planet. How many of you have read The Hiding Place? Corrie Ten Boom saved multiple Jewish families and individuals. Her parents were killed by the Nazis. Her sister was killed by the Nazis. She was let free through an accident. Oh, sorry, it wasn't really. It was God's provision. But what about her sister? What about her parents? What about all those others who were killed? Punished for no fault of their own except they were Jews. And Hitler felt that the Jews were less than dogs. You know, Jesus promised that we would have trouble in this world. He promised that we would be persecuted for righteousness' sake. He told us that we shouldn't be surprised when the world hates you. I find myself scratching my head when I hear Christians who find themselves surprised and frustrated and angry that they're being mistreated because they're Christians. Saying, what's surprising about this? It's not pleasant. But it shouldn't be a surprise. If you're living your life for Jesus, be prepared for it. Just as Daniel and his friends, they were innocent, but they were still experiencing being torn away from that which they loved. And they still had that ongoing battle to surrender to the culture around them. It would have been so much simpler if they would have just done that. But they didn't. And you and I can take heart. Because greater is He that is in you than he that is in the world. Jesus says, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. He also says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. He goes on, He says, I am with you always. He says, blessed are you when you're persecuted for righteousness' sake. And as we always go back to James, consider it pure joy, my brothers, when we encounter trials of various kinds. All of these promises that we're going to be in a pickle on this planet. But we still are to witness and to testify of the love of Jesus Christ to a dying world. Next slide. Not only should we be faithful in a culture which is foreign to us and that we find distasteful at best, we're reminded that we have to be faithful even among false teachings. You see, the world who hates Jesus will also hate the Christian. And please don't think I'm trying to be a downer. I'm not. I just want us to understand these things. And to be quite frank, it's kind of exciting. Because the stronger Satan steps up his attacks against the church, the stronger Christ is seen as his children. Submit and obey Jesus. We're promised in God's word that it's going to be miserable for us on this planet because the world is going to try to label us and describe us as that which we're not. Have you been called racist or bigoted or a hater? Yeah. Most of us as believers have been called that. And you know that's the absolute farthest thing from the truth there is for the true follower of Jesus Christ. Anybody that would dare to call me a hateful person, a bigoted person, does not know Leonard. And they do not know my Jesus. Because that's the farthest thing that I am. And for most of you, I believe that's the farthest thing from who you are. The Babylonians did that to Daniel and his three friends. Today the world is speaking about the church in such negative terms. But rather than trying to fit in and agree, and rather than change your belief system, be faithful to God and His Word. We can still do what we're required to do in this nation without compromising who we are in Jesus Christ. Next slide. Some of you may be thinking of several situations. Well, we went too far. Let's back up one. May be thinking of several situations which have been a part of the news lately. You may be asking questions as to whether the responses of some of these individuals who are Christians, whether the responses have been biblical or not. And the reality is, my friends, some of the answers are going to be discovered by you in the weeks and months ahead as we continue our study in Daniel. But some of you already know the answers because you know God's Word. Some of you are thinking ahead as to the responses which these four men, Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, will make when they're being told, compromise or die. And you're able to put it all together here. Don't allow the world or even others who claim to speak for Christ shape your thinking. The only people who are speaking for Christ out there right now are those who are in total agreement with the Bible, the Word of God, and they will not back down and say, well, yes, you're probably right. Bible says something is a certain way. It is. It doesn't matter what the polls say. It doesn't matter what politicians state. It doesn't even matter what some of these reverends state that are out there sharing a lie just so they can be accepted amongst the media. If we compromise and become just like the proverbial Babylonians, willing to compromise so as to fit into the culture and the teachings of the majority, we are of no value as a witness for the cause of Jesus Christ. Next slide. Go back to the reality. God is faithful. What's keeping us from being faithful? Fear of man. We don't fear man. We don't fear man. As we sing our last song together, I want you to think about these verses. Think about being faithful because of God's faithfulness. And allow the Holy Spirit to move you to be obedient.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and
regardless of what's happening, remember the great things that God has done in your life. If nothing else, just go back to, Lord, I was your enemy, yet you loved me, you saved me, you made me your child. Oh, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. I would invite you to just sit down for just a few minutes, if you would please. We have just a couple of items we want to discuss.